Welcome to episode 2 of the Anarchy Gumbo podcast. We have another very, very late middle of the night talk here with a very important porcupine, Ian Freeman from Free Talk Live
and
founder of the Liberty Radio Network. And he's just man about town, keen New Hampshire man about town and Liberty mover and shaker who helps move and shake people to New Hampshire. How you doing there, Ian?
I am well, thank you.
Thanks, man.
Thanks for inviting me.
Thanks. Nice having you.
Sure.
Yeah. We were chatting before this started, and I was like, why aren't we recording this? We were talking about all sorts of stuff that people don't usually talk about. We're talking about codecs, and the you turned me on to this program, Mumble. I've done quite a bit of blogging about it. It's the program we're talking over, and it also records, and it sounds better than Skype. And it's also more secure than Skype in its architecture, and also in the fact that the people who run the servers for it have stated that they will not respond to law enforcement demands to reveal anything.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
Unlike the mega corporation that owns Skype.
Yep. I don't know how that works. I don't know how you can refuse those things, but people can. Maybe it's by not having a big brick and mortar office somewhere.
Hey, I'm sorry. Hang on a second. Speaking of Mumble, I have to deal with a technical difficulty that comes up every now and then with this particular program, and that is that when you run it 24 hours a day, as I do, eventually it has some kind of a little bug in it that makes the audio go all to crap, and that's what just happened to the people that were connected to it at the moment on my server. Anyway, I think everything's okay now.
Do you have to restart it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Is it restarted? Which
it is.
Mm-hmm. So do I have to start recording? Right. Do I have to start recording again? No, it seems like it's
no. It was my server, not yours.
The LRN server.
Yeah, show the time right now.
I probably shouldn't tell you this, but I accidentally almost cut into a live show about 5 minutes before you got on because I was firing up Mumble and have it set to. I have to turn this off, but I have it set to connect to last server.
Right.
And instead of connecting to my server, it connected to your server, and I didn't have the headphones on, but I had the mic on. But fortunately, I didn't have the phantom power on yet on my mic, so you know it didn't hear me talking to the wife about the cats and where are my pants and things like that over liberty conspiracy. They would have thought it was a liberty conspiracy, probably. Maybe the government's talking over them. So we were talking about Phoenix, Arizona, and how it's a hotbed for rich libertarians. How does that happen?
Honestly, I really don't know much about who lives in Phoenix. I know that Ernie Hancock apparently knows some people that have some money. I don't know if that means they live in Phoenix or elsewhere in the Southwest. So really, I couldn't tell you. I do know that someone's visiting in Keene from the Phoenix area who is probably going to make a move up pretty soon. So Phoenix cool. is losing its liberty base.
Well, I know it's the base for the Goldwater Institute, and in some odd way, Barry Goldwater is considered the grandfather of the Libertarian Party, although he was the guy that wanted to bomb the Vietnamese back to the Stone Age to end the war and save lives. But
I'll take your word for it.
Oh yeah, but Phoenix has a lot of, I guess I'd say like Cato type libertarian businessmen, retirees, or Cato, not Cato. What's the other one? Bush brothers type. Is that it? Bush, Coors? No.
I'll take your word for it. I know nothing about Phoenix except for the fact that Ernie Hancock and some great activists live there, and also Joe Arpaio is the sheriff, who is the worst sheriff that I've ever heard of.
Yeah, he reminds me of a slave driver on the horse with the whip.
He's insane, actually. Just absolutely mad with power, and a very scary man. And I don't understand why anyone who loves liberty would live in Phoenix.
The weather? I don't know.
It's hot as hell.
Maybe it's because guns and weed are both legal there.
What?
Well,
weed is
it's a medical marijuana state.
Oh, well, that's not quite legal, but yeah, that's cool.
Right and on. it recently, last year or so, became a put the gun in your pocket without a permission slip state.
Oh, that's good. Good on them.
How's that going in New Hampshire? I
think I'd rather stay away from Joe Arpaio and his goons.
Yeah.
Maybe it's got guns and weed going for it, but for the rest of it, anything you do they don't like, they're going to put you in a tent city out in the desert and feed you gruel.
and make you wear pink panties while you do it.
Yeah. No, which thanks.
Is the least of all the problems of that. So
absolutely true.
Talk a little bit about how you came to liberty. And then the second question is going to be, which may segue into this with your answer or not, how you came to run the media empire you run. It's it's inspiring to me. The media empire you run. I'm working on, matching you without being in competition with you, because I think there's room for both of it. So I want to pick your brain on everything you can tell me. But
okay, sure.
Yeah, go.
So I smoked pot for the first time at age 16, and I think for me that was a real eye opener, because you know they told you in DARE class that everything is evil and pot is like heroin and this is all bad, and I guess I determined that I'd been lied to, and so ended up becoming a more open-minded to other things I might have been lied to about. Somehow ended up finding the Harry Brown campaign in the year 2000 for the Libertarian Party, and absolutely really appreciated what he had to say. I got his book Why Government Doesn't Work and his follow-up book The Great Libertarian Offer. And really, it was Harry Brown and his brilliance at communicating that brought me into the movement. So got active in Sarasota, Florida with the Harry Brown campaign in 2000. That kind of got me connected with the people that at one time called themselves the Libertarian Party because it had existed in the 90s and then kind of disbanded and then got formed again after the Harry Brown campaign. And, you know, I worked with those guys a lot and got kind of experience in the world of doing politics and outreach. And found the Free State Project in the early aughts, created my show Free Talk Live in 2002 on a local talk radio station, kind of took it around to different stations, and ended up moving up to New Hampshire as part of the Free State Project in 2006, because I didn't want to stay down south where I was pretty much the only one organizing anything of note as far as activism was concerned, and where it was like pulling teeth to try to get people to actually volunteer for relatively simple activism of sort of the outreach format. And so I made the move and haven't looked back. So does that answer your question about how I got in?
Briefly, how old are you?
I am 31. 31.
I'm 47. I'm an old dude. I don't feel old, but
that's good.
What kind of microphone do you use?
I'm on an RE27 right now.
I thought you were on an Electro Voice. What's different than that from an RE20?
It's newer.
Because I'm just thinking, like, I'm listening to you over Mumble right now, and I'm like, this sounds exactly like Free Talk Live, like you on Free Talk Live. And it's, you know, it's your voice, but it's also the microphone.
It's an RE27 running through a Symmetrix 528E voice processor, so that's doing something to it, too.
RE27. And what's the voice processor?
The Symmetrix 528E.
528E?
That's correct.
Cool. Cool.
So it's basically a $500 mic running through a $500 processor, but I paid probably about $350 for each.
Did you buy them from some radio station that didn't need them anymore, going out of business or something?
I forget. There's places that offer used equipment. And maybe I bought the mics new, but it was like a special deal. I don't really recall. It's been so many years.
I had an RE20 for a while, and I bought it, and it smelled bad, so I returned it. I think it was like, it was sold as new, but I think it was like someone had bought it and returned it within 7 days or something, but was, you know, chain smoking and drinking beer and eating onions while using it or something. That's one thing I would say is never buy mics used, because after they warm up and you're using them, they'll smell like whoever used to use them.
Well, that's interesting. A lot of people use the mics here at the LRN.FM studio, so, because we produce multiple shows here. So
they smell like weed and tofu.
You know, you shouldn't really smoke in your studio. It's not a good idea.
I thought you were going to say you shouldn't really say weed and tofu. Like, you shouldn't make fun of us.
So, yeah, so that's how I got my start. Libertarian Party stuff in Florida, and then made the move up here where there's actually some significant activism happening.
What do you think of the future? I mean, I kind of vacillate between feeling a lot of hope for liberty and being really fired out about it, and then just up about it, and then just seeing so much tyranny today in the headlines, and just thinking, ugh, it's a losing battle. We're fucked. And you can cuss on this podcast.
Oh, okay.
If that's okay with you. I didn't ask you about that. If this is going to be syndicated, can we cuss or not occasionally?
You know, there was a time when there was a pirate radio station operating here in Keene, and we knew who the operator was, and that person was not in favor of the idea of having curse words on the air, which is kind of weird. You're like a pirate operator
clean mouth pirates
language. But anyway, so we were kind of being deferent towards that person because it was pretty important to have a transmitter here in Keene, but that station's off the air at this time, and that person doesn't live here. So I really am not too concerned with it. I think that it's better because it'll probably be just airing during the overnights anyway. It's probably not the end of the world if there's some curse words.
Yeah. Yeah, I judiciously beep all of the cussing and freedom fiends and try really hard not to do it on the live show. But, you know, I mean, in life, I just cuss like a sailor. So I'd like to have this, you know, I think this is going to be the, you know, I'm not going to probably put ads on this show, and it's going to be my no holds barred back to the roots of podcasting of, you know, no worries.
Gotcha.
So fucking A, thanks, man. Thank you for
Fuck
permission
it.
To cuss. Fuck it. It's funny. Ian is like the gatekeeper in my life if I have one, but I don't really have one, but I, you know, figured I'd ask out of respect. So the filthy mouth pirates wouldn't care. I mean, I think that one reason that people would care with piracy is if that tends to be one thing that gets people turned into the FCC is cussing.
It's true. That's a possibility. It'll certainly identify you as not a regular broadcaster if they hear that on the air.
Although I'm wondering what they think if they hear, you know, 24/7 bashing the government with clean language. Would that be any different? And I've also wondered what would happen if somebody ran like a 500-watt pirate station where they just talked 24/7 about how great the government is. Do you think they'd get shut down or not if they weren't stepping if they weren't stepping on anyone?
I don't know. It's a good question. Normally the people that are going to complain about pirate station are the competitors. So usually it's those people that are paying them the greatest attention to who else is on the band. They're the more likely to pick you up, and or the radio rats who, if you go to the radio info forums, radio-info.com, these are people who just, they
status,
are very obedient. Yeah.
Status ham operators with too much time on their hands, retirees.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. They are very upset that someone would have gone through the trouble and difficulty and cost of getting a government license. And how dare you put a transmitter on the air without asking the government's permission, because that's what they did. And so it's the old slave on slave violence, sort of Stockholm syndrome situation.
And they're probably old enough that they probably had to learn Morse code to be able to do it.
Because
that was a requirement until like 5 years ago for
a
ham license. It's not a bad thing to learn. I tried when I was a kid. I had the ham part down, but I couldn't. I mean, I'd learned Morse code. I don't remember it anymore, but I knew it. But I was having trouble with the math of the written test when I was like 12. But yeah, I think it'd be interesting. I mean, I'd never encourage anyone to do anything illegal, but I think it'd be interesting.
Oh, I would.
I think it'd be interesting if someone ever, you know, got a really powerful transmitter, you know, 100 watts or something, and set up a pirate station where all they did was just said wonderful glowing things about the government, but in a totally sarcastic voice. But, you know, if you had a transcription of it, it would look like the newspaper or the evening news.
That's a funny idea. You should do that.
My wife she lets me do whatever I want, except putting any kind of antennas on our building or transmitting any frequencies from our house.
Well, I'm not serious. I think that if you're going to spend money on a decent 100 watt transmitter, because those aren't cheap, if you're going to do that, then you should really put the Liberty message out there. And you don't have to put it on your own property. You could put it somewhere else if you want
to.
That's why LRN.FM has a KU band signal, so you can receive anywhere with the view of the southern sky.
Yep. What are the callers from K that are listening on KU band? Are they kind of Dale Gribble-ish, the ones that call in?
We had one lady that I think was kind of not liberty friendly, and maybe like a religious zealot. If you've ever set up a KU band dish and surfed through the free to air channels, you'll find that there's a whole lot of religious programming up there.
Yeah.
And there's religious radio channels and religious television channels. Aside from that, there are several international channels with different languages. Like, you know, there's Asian channels and Indian channels or Middle Eastern. So it's, you know, it's an interesting eclectic mix. I always wonder how many people are actually listening to us via that method. And Mark seems to, my business partner, on-air co-host Mark, he is convinced that it's a huge waste of my money. And I just don't know. I mean, I like the the technology myself, the delivery system, and I feel like if there are people that are going to take LRN.FM for pirate broadcasts or community radio broadcasts, then it's a very, very viable method of delivering that audio. So for the money that I'm spending on it, I feel like it's a worthwhile addition to my little hobby here, which is really what LRN.FM is. It's a hobby that, sure, it'd be nice to make it into some sort of a professional thing someday, but that would cost a whole lot more money.
Do you make a living at it?
Oh, no, absolutely not. I spend money on LRN.FM. It's, you know, it's a way I spend several thousand dollars per year of the money that I earn.
You know, my thought on the satellite thing is, do you ever see the movie Man Who Fell to Earth with David Bowie?
No, I've not.
He's an alien who lands on the Earth and has a bunch of alien technology and sells the patents and becomes the richest man on Earth in like 3 years. But he's basically just trying to steal Earth's water to take it back to his planet because his planet is drying out and his family is dying. So, but one of the things he does is he wants to send a message to his wife. So he pays to record an album of love songs to her and then has some AM radio, you know, AM station play his record. He buys ad time and plays it. And he's like, well, they'll be able to hear that from my planet. And I'm thinking maybe the LRN satellite is transmitting to other planets.
Doesn't seem likely. The KU band pattern is directed at the North American continent. So, no, I don't think so.
Damn. So, back to the what do you think about the future? I don't know how I asked that question and got off it, but I think it was a microphone question. But
yeah, something like that.
So, are you hopeful or
well,
not?
Well, yeah. I mean, obviously, if I wasn't hopeful, I probably wouldn't do any of the things I'm doing. I mean, I'd probably just keep my head down and play video games all the time or something like that. And I've been playing too many video games recently, which is why I haven't been waking up in the morning, but just for the last week. Last week I got up every single morning and I was very proud of myself for that. But I think generally, yeah, I've got hope, obviously. I mean, I think that especially since I've moved to New Hampshire, the hope has really been much more prevalent in my life. I was much more angry and, you know, upset at the world and the situation in which we find ourselves when I was down in Florida. And when I wasn't surrounded by other people who have a similar mindset and being around those other people just helps you have more hope. I mean, it just makes things more tangible as far as, wow, we really can accomplish some things here if we get enough folks together, which is why I think that it's important we get even more people here.
Do you have a wife and kids?
Nope, sure don't. Which makes it a lot easier to get arrested and stuff.
Yeah, I've never been arrested, and I don't say that like I'm proud, like a lot of people, you know.
Oh, give them time.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I don't break any laws. It's an experiment I'm doing.
Oh, really?
I don't break any obvious laws. I also don't leave the house. I don't leave the house a lot. I mean, I'm not a curmudgeon, but it's just, yeah. I have a really, we have built a very comfortable nest here, so I don't have to leave a whole lot. And it seems that people generally get arrested when they're outside their house, unless, you know, they're arrested in their house, which happens, yeah. But.
For sure. Well, I used to be that way when I lived in Florida. I didn't go out very much at all. I didn't have much of a social life, and that completely changed up here. There's so much to do.
It's hard to have a social life here, and I'm okay with it. I mean, I used to be one of the most social.
You're in Wyoming, correct?
Yeah, I used to be one of the most social people I knew. And at some point around age 30, I just realized, you know, I don't need to live in the city. I don't have to have junkies pawing through my trash cans at 3 a.m. to feel alive and feel like I'm a real writer living the dream.
From what city did you move?
I lived in San Francisco for 16 years, and then I lived in Los Angeles for 10.
Got it.
So
I know there are junkies here in Keene, but I've never had that problem, so it's probably not near as bad here.
Yeah, they probably don't paw through your garbage as much. And you know, basically what happened with our journey to liberty was kind of the real short version of it is, you know, I've always not liked authority since I was like 5. I mean, I have letters from my kindergarten teacher talking about my problems with it, but
oppositional defiance disorder, as I've heard it's called.
We had an ad for that. Did you hear the ad we did for Compliacin? No, I'll have to send you the Compliacin ad. It's a fake drug that we made up.
If it's 60 seconds or 30, I can probably put it in.
I could do a version of it. It's fucking
hilarious. Give me a 60 because I've got a parody rotator that I'm sure you've heard running with several Onion News.
I love the Onion, man. Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. So I took a bunch of the Onion spots that are like, or the Onion, I guess, podcasts, which vary in length, and I chopped a bunch of them up to make them 60 seconds. So that would be a perfect addition to our.
Oh, you did a good job with that. I thought that was a feed they provided.
Nope, that's all by cutting.
It's so well cut.
The onion does have a feed, and we do run that in the podcast loop. It runs toward the very top of the podcast loop because they update it fairly often. So then you'll get the uncut ones right at the top of the podcast loop at LRN.fm. But otherwise, if you hear an onion during like one of the regular breaks of one of the shows, then that's one of the 60-second ones.
So tell me about your media empire and how you built it and what it is and where it's going.
Well, I'm not sure if it can be defined as an empire, but I do have a humble little...
A city state.
I do have a humble little hobby internet network called LRN.fm, which is also available on satellite, as we discussed earlier. And I encourage people to use that because I do encourage illegal behavior as long as it's peaceful and doesn't harm others. I don't care what you do. And in fact, I think pirate radio or community radio or micro radio or whatever moniker you want to assign to it is one of the most effective forms of activism that someone can engage in, and that the risk isn't really as high as it might appear to be unless you live in somewhere like Florida where they actually have a state statute they've passed against running a pirate radio station.
Really?
So it's particularly risky in the state of Florida. They will arrest you and charge you criminally with running a pirate radio station there. But I think it's pretty important because, you know, for a relatively small city, 50 watts can cover pretty much the whole area. And, you know, if you need more, you can always pay for bigger transmitters. But a relatively small transmitter and a relatively small investment can result in thousands and hundreds, if not thousands and thousands of people hearing the ideas of liberty who otherwise weren't planning on hearing it because they were just simply scanning the band in your local area. And if you've got enough people who are willing to help with the project, you can have setups where, for instance, you've got like antennas at different locations with all the cabling all set up. And then you can just move the transmitter around as is necessary after the FCC tracks down one transmitter site. You can just move to a different one and basically give them hell because, you know, they're not designed to run or to operate with activists being their opposition. You know, they're used to just coming after the lone guy who, you know, there wasn't enough reggae on the air, so he wanted to put some reggae on, or somebody wanted to hear heavy metal on the radio. These are your standard pirate radio operators, just somebody that wanted to fill a niche on the air, and they're not necessarily, you know, principled, liberty-minded people. Well, what happens when the FCC goes up against somebody that really is a liberty-minded person, somebody that understands that you don't open the door to the police, that you don't talk to the police, because a lot of these people running radio stations are going to talk their way right into an FCC citation. They're going to let them in. They're going to let the FCC inspect their house and like all kinds of crazy stuff that no one who really has any experience dealing with the police would ever do. So I think it would be interesting to see how the tables would be turned in those particular situations. And so I want to encourage people to put up you know, micro radio stations and broadcast the ideas of liberty as far and as wide as possible. I think it's very effective activism.
I've heard of in England people making really cheap, powerful transmitters that they consider disposable and just putting them on the rooftops of other people's buildings that they just, you know, walk into. And they'll even what they often do as a joke is they'll put a beer and a note for the official who finds it.
Now, are they running it from a car battery or something like that? Like, what are they using?
I don't know. I think maybe going into the power of the house, or maybe solar powered, or I don't know.
Because that's the tricky part, right?
I don't think they consider them so disposable that, you know, they just use a carbon battery and when it dies, it dies. I think it's meant to go for weeks or so until they're found. Right. But
yeah, because that's the only thing you really need if you're going to do a transmitter site would be power. Because the LRN.fm offers the KU band feed. As long as you've got power in view of a southern sky, you have a transmitter site. So it doesn't even necessarily have to be on your property. You could put it up anywhere where it's possible to have power. And if you're only dealing with something like, you know, a 50-watt transmitter or less, audio equipment is not a heavy draw on power. So it probably would be possible to set up some sort of alternative power like, you know, solar power or something like that to power a station if you really are completely off the grid.
Well, I've seen eBay has all those little ones made in Hong Kong that have anywhere from 100 milliwatts to, you know, there's ones that are like 10 or 20 watts that are under.
Yep, that's right.
They're like $50 each. I mean, the shipping, and that's with shipping. I mean, they take like 2 months to get to you, but they're so cheap that they could be considered disposable. They do run on AC power, but they could be hooked up to, you know, an iPod or a cheaper MP3 player with running on a loop and probably wired into a house. You know, I think a lot of old buildings, there's probably access to the power on the roof somewhere too. And a lot of old buildings have, probably in England more than here, but have antennas of thing, you know, different antennas and discs on the roof. So it wouldn't look out of place to see another antenna there if it didn't look home, if it did not look homemade.
Yeah, it's a cool world, cool little world of activism, and, you know, way more interesting and exciting for people than going out and handing out pamphlets on the street. And of course, because it's effective is one of the reasons why the FCC is very concerned about it. I mean, they don't want you going out there doing that stuff. It took them about 8 months though to come up and respond to the Keene station. So usually you can go for quite a while before those bureaucrats will get around to doing anything. First, they have to have complaints come in, and then they actually have to do something about it.
I've looked at some of the FCC. I've looked at the FCC site where they publish their complaints and their actions. And actually, most of them are against commercial stations for bleeding into other stations or things like that, or not being shielded enough.
That's true. I don't know how true those complaints are, but those are typically what you'll hear is that they are interfering with the aircraft band or something like that.
And a lot of the one I looked up for my area, and the only ones were, you know, my cable TV company, and it was the FCC had gone out and done field tests and decided that the equipment was leaking too much on the site.
I did the LRN.FM thing, and I launched that in 2009. It was almost all podcasts at that time, except for Free Talk Live. And today we've got over 13 hours per day of live programming on the network, which I think is great. And of course, your show was probably the newest live show. And we've got a few more podcasts that are probably going to be added within the next couple weeks when I finally get around to sampling them and pulling the necessary switches to make that happen. But the basic concept was simple, was that I know that Free Talk Live isn't right for everybody. It's, you know, probably not intellectual enough for some people, or maybe too intellectual for others, or whatever, or they don't like our personalities, or they don't like the subject matter, or how we approach it. So I figured, well, there's all these other great liberty shows out there. Maybe they'll be more likely to like someone like Stefan Molyneux or Wheels Off Liberty or the Freedom Fiends or whatever. And so I figured, well, let's bring the best of the liberty people together in one place, keep out the conspiracy kooks, and you know, create a real liberty network, unlike the conspiracy kookery that's out there that was pretty much the prevalent choice for, if you wanted to find any show that had some sort of a semblance of a liberty message, it would have been sandwiched in between or was one of the nutso shows. So yeah. I wanted to make sure that I had something that would stand out from that particular viewpoint.
Yeah, I listen.
That's what I put on the air.
I listen to the LRN feed several hours a day, often late at night. So I've heard all the shows a little bit at least, and I don't think I've heard anyone talking about the CIA implanting microchips in our brains while we sleep.
Nope, pretty much. I mean, obviously, I can't do a whole lot of vetting of every show before they get on. But all that's just because I just don't have enough time. I wish I had a, you know, second me that could do more program directing for LRN. But I do my best at kind of getting a feel for a show and whether or not they're having a good time and whether or not they're principled. And if I feel like both of those things are happening, then that's usually good enough for me. So that's my empire or whatever. And I also have Free Talk Live that is on over 100 radio stations, AM and FM. I suppose that's a little bit more commercially successful than LRN.FM. Free Talk Live actually makes money, but then again, it's been going for almost a decade now.
Oh, I think earlier, I don't know if you misspoke or I misheard. I thought you were saying Free Talk Live was a hobby that did not make
money. No, LRN.FM.
You're talking about LRN. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I misspoke.
That's my hobby.
All right.
Free Talk Live was my hobby, and it became a paying business, which was, you know, it's nice when that finally happens when you run a business. It took about five or six years for it to finally start making money. And I have no intentions of, you know, right now LRN.FM is just a fun thing that I do to help get the message of freedom out and help promote these other shows and kind of bring the audiences, cross-pollinate the audiences between them and help them all kind of expand their purview within the community or the liberty community. So maybe LRN.FM will become something that's profitable someday, but as of right now, it's how I spend some of my profits.
How many hours a week do you work?
Well, it would depend on how you define work, right? Because, you know, I don't have a clock that I punch in on. Obviously, I'm on the air for 18 hours per week. After the show, I'm probably editing the archives and posting them for up to, you know, between 30 minutes and an hour, depending on how lazy I'm being about it. And then, let's see, I mean, when I get up in the morning, I'm calling radio stations, but at the same time, I'm on Facebook, or I'm trying not to be on Facebook, so, like, you know, there's work here, and then there's not work there, and then it would be hard. I can work as much as I want, and I'm a pretty, you know, business-oriented person. Obviously, you don't get to 100 radio stations by not picking up the phone and calling them, so I've made a lot of phone calls. And I've done a lot of the, you know, behind the scenes engineering for Free Talk Live and for LRN.FM. So, I mean, the work never ends. It's you run your own business. You can pour as much time into it as you want to.
Are those 100 stations, are any of them commercial stations?
All of them are commercial stations.
Okay.
I think. Let me see. I'd have to think real hard to think if we don't have a commercial station. I'm pretty sure they're all commercial stations. It would be hard for us to get on a college station because we just inherently are a commercial show. There's ads during the show, and those wouldn't fly on a non-com.
Yeah. So what do you think about infiltration of the liberty movement, about how much there might be and in what direction? What I'm thinking about is I read this thing about Cass Sunstein, the czar under Obama, wrote an article a few years ago basically talking about the problem with government conspiracy theories about the government damaging the government's ability to do its job, and saying that his suggested solution was to have paid operatives working for the government infiltrating these conversations online and inserting the truth subtly into them, what he called the truth, you know, that the government's great and whatever, and they didn't do the things that people are saying they did. And then
I remember hearing about that. I think we talked about that years ago.
And then he talked about his need to the need to balance not doing too much of this or doing it too intensely, because if it were exposed, it would undermine the whole operation. And I'm thinking this was a publicly published paper. It's already been exposed, but how much of that do you think you've ever directly encountered that?
Some sort of undermining attempts?
Undermining or the opposite of, you know, like what you were talking about today about people trying to goad you into things. Have you ever encountered that?
There was a guy that showed up here a few weeks ago, and he kind of showed up under weird circumstances, and he set off the radar, some red flags with a demo from Coplock, and demo kind of gave us a heads up to how he was feeling about him, and we asked some questions of the dude, and he, within 5 minutes of meeting me and talking to me for the first time, dropped that he was in a militia, and I just kind of thought, huh, that's kind of a weird thing to tell somebody first 5 minutes you meet him.
Yeah.
And, you know, freekeen.com is my blog site. The tagline is peaceful evolution. And if you blog at Freekeen, you don't believe in violence as a solution. So I thought, that's kind of a weird thing for someone to say. It's sort of a red flag for me. But there were a few other things that he did that were definitely some questionable, behavior. And so I don't know if he was actually somebody who is an infiltrator or whatever, but I don't really care. I mean, from my perspective, if you are someone who's advocating violence, I don't want to be associated with you. And I'm not saying that being in a militia means you're advocating violence, but I think that it does kind of belie someone who's coming from a perspective of, we need to prep up and get prepared for the end, and they're going to attack, and we need to fight back, and this kind of mindset. And I used to have that mindset, so, you know, I'm familiar with it. But I feel like that's not the kind of person I want to be around. So either there's someone who's misled, and I'd be happy to talk to them about their viewpoint and, you know, explain to them why I don't think it's effective or moral. And if they don't want to change their viewpoint, then I don't want to spend my time on that person anymore. So after a while, after talking to him at you know, some detail about his particular views on violence as a solution, which he did believe in, when we finally got into it, I told him, you know, hey, look, you know, I'm sorry, but this really isn't. I don't really think it's the right movement for you, and I appreciate it if you left. And so he left. So again, I don't really care whether or not he was working for the government. Either way, I don't want that person around because that's not my bag. It's not my style of activism. I don't believe it's effective, etc. As far as the rest of the paranoia is concerned, I operate my life as though everybody already knows what I'm up to. That I'm already infiltrated, and I'm not afraid of what could happen because I know that terrible things can happen. These are government people. They're violent. They're dangerous. But I realize that if they're already infiltrating, they already know what I'm up to. And so why try to hide it? Why be paranoid about it? Why, you know, constantly question everybody you come across? Either live free and be proud of what you do as long as you're not hurting anybody else. That's kind of how I approach my life. So I don't know if I've answered your question.
I say that I bug my own house with podcasting.
I would not
want the government to bug my house, but I'm not one of those people who says, I don't care if the government bugs my phone and internet because it keeps me safe. I was at one point, so I can understand having an insane attitude like that. But if they did bug my house, there's nothing that they would learn about me that they wouldn't learn by listening to Freedom Fiends, you know?
Yeah, that's how I feel about it. I mean, if you've got some infiltrator that's in my group, okay, so he's probably going to come across some people drinking and some people, consuming cannabis every now and then and, talking about the activism they're planning. But none of it's violent because that's not the group that we're in. You know, it's like we were talking on our show on Free Talk Live tonight about the FBI infiltrating the mosques, and the mosque that this one guy was infiltrating was reported him to the FBI because he was talking about violence, and they got a restraining order against the dude because he wouldn't stop talking about violence. And these folks are like, hey, that's not what we're about. You must have gotten the wrong idea, buddy. Muslims aren't all a bunch of violent crazies in the same way that Christians aren't all the same. I thought that was pretty interesting because that's basically how it is here. You come around and start talking about violence, people aren't going to want to be around you because that's just not how we're approaching things. And so any attempts they've made to send people in our midst, and we've been suspicious of some people in the past due to their behavior, and they all of a sudden leave, and there's certain behavior that might be more applicable to an infiltrator, whether they be on the federal payroll or they're just somebody that's working to try to get out of a criminal charge or, you know, an informant, that sort of thing. You just can't live your life paranoid of those sorts of things. It'll drive you crazy.
Yeah, I'm not paranoid of it. I ran across that Cass sunscreen article today and was just like, this sounds like a battle plan from 5 years ago, and I think they're doing it.
Let them come in, you know, as long as they're not talking about violence, they'll be able to hang around with us and talk about liberty, and I don't know, maybe they'll get a few new ideas.
I've actually thought about that. I mean, I am convinced that every bit of liberty media is being consumed by, if not a computer, but probably a person too.
Oh, I know for a fact that up here in New Hampshire, the government bureaucrats are frequently on our websites and are very familiar with our content. In fact, when I was in jail, I had multiple jail guards commenting to me on what they thought about the blogs at Free Keen. I mean, so you can look at the IP addresses.
Were
you
can they see fans? They're coming from.
Yeah, I think they like some of the things they saw, but they don't like some other things. Everybody's got their critique. Everybody has their opinion on what they think is a good activism and what's not. But my point being that, yes, absolutely, they are very, very interested in our movement.
Well, maybe, I mean, I'm thinking some of them might be swayed too. If their job is to sit in a cubicle and listen to the whole free talk or LRN feed 24/7 and
sure.
in eight hour shifts, you know, it'd be kind of hard to listen to that 24/7 without, or even in 8 hour shifts without having some of it have an effect probably.
Oh, of course. And, no doubt about it. And I think that, ultimately a lot of these guys already agree with us on a number of things. In fact, you know, where I live, the guy that runs the jail, Rick Van Wickler, is a member of Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. So the last time I was in the jail, one of the guards that was booking me pointed out to me that he was wearing a leap, and it's true. And he's not the only guard in the jail that is a member of Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. So, I mean, I'm not going to take credit for them. Obviously, the warden is the member of leap, but cool. it's kind of cool to be in an environment like that. You know,
that's a brave thing for an active policeman to do. It's largely retired policemen, isn't it?
Leap. That's true, but these aren't policemen. They're corrections officers.
I see. So part three. Hi, Ian.
Hey.
Hey. Hey, your voice just sounds like you have a good attitude about the world.
You know, why not?
I don't know, because the world's a fucking horrible place sometimes.
Oh, things are getting better all the time.
Yeah, talk to me when you're my age. You goddamn whippersnappers don't understand. I don't know. I don't know.
I can see how you'd feel that way living out in Wyoming. It must be tough.
Really? Really? You gonna turn this into a pimping for the for?
Of course. I'll tell
you. Okay. Here's
I'm
why I'm not
pimping New Hampshire.
I'm not moving to New Hampshire because I am such a charismatic person in person that there would be young ladies fawning over me 24/7. And
please
it would
bring them with you. We totally need more women in this.
No,
movement.
The ones there would do it because my wife would be bummed out by it.
Well, I think that'd be great. We need more liberty-minded women. So if you can convert some of the locals, that'd be fantastic.
I've lived in New Hampshire. I've spent summers there as a kid. My sister lived there, and I liked it a lot. I did a lot of it's a great place, but not for us. We're set in Wyoming, and we own a house here. We're not going to sell it and move to New Hampshire. And we're kind of I'm a curmudgeon. I like to stay indoors. I wouldn't
New Hampshire winters are great for that, I'd like to say.
Well, I would not be uncomfortable, you know, I would not be uncomfortable in a bunch of people standing out in public doing activism, but it wouldn't do anything for me. And Wyoming has an opposite problem of like, you know, I had one good friend here in the 3 years I've lived here, and it was Nima, and then he moved away. So it's and I'm sort of courting a fellow now. We're actually having
as a new potential friend.
As a new potential friend, we're checking each other out. I'm going on friend dates with somebody. But I mean, this is the kind of place where like the Occupy Wall Street in Casper, Wyoming, and Casper is you know, tied with Cheyenne for the biggest city in the state. The Occupy Wall Street here was one day and it was 15 people and it made the paper and nobody noticed or cared and the cops didn't care. It wasn't enough for the cops to even go look at it, you know?
So tell me then, if you found that New Hampshire was having all these wonderful liberty things happening and like, you know, weed was fully legalized and guns were fully legalized and, you know, like all this stuff was happening. Would you say that there was like, there's no point at which New Hampshire becomes a clear choice where you're like, oh crap, all right, I got to sell this house. I got to get out there because something's really happening there. You just would rather just stay right where you are?
I never say never. The proximity to Boston and Washington, D.C. really bugs me, you know, and I did a lot of actuary analysis of various states even before, you know, when I was voting Democrat, my wife and I were trying to get out of California and we had it down to five states based on cost of living, weather, cost of, you know, low taxes and just general leave me the fuck alone. You know, like it's okay to be left the fuck alone. And it was five states. Unfortunately, one of them was not New Hampshire. But it was, I think it was Wyoming, Kentucky, Washington, West Virginia, and, maybe Arizona. I don't remember, but you know, and then I read the book You and the Police by Boston Tea Party. Ever seen that book? It's, yep. I mean, I think that I see that stuff every day. I got to get Pete Ayer on here because one question I have for him is, have you ever read that book? Because everything that he does on camera looks like it's out of that book. But
yeah, that was one of my first, I guess, introductions to how to handle the cops. And it was great. It's really useful.
Yeah. And, you know, I read it. Basically, it was like my journey to liberty was I was kind of already there. I kind of didn't like any kind of authority, but someone tried to break into our house and I said, baby, we're buying a shotgun. And she said, but that's admitting that the world's a bad place. And I said, sometimes the world's a bad place and I love you and we're getting a shotgun. And, you know, being the one Democrat who still has balls intact and was married in California, I went and bought one anyway, even though my wife didn't want me to and went out shooting with her. And, you know, she was like, I love this. Let's get more guns. So, you know, then we got some handguns and then we started reading up on the law of it and discovered that, you know, being a honest, nonviolent gun owner in California, it's hard to not break the law.
Yeah.
And I was ordering gun books online and a related book, you know, on Amazon. People who bought this also bought, you know, I bought Boston's Gun Bible and I also bought, You and the Police. I read You and the Police in one sitting. And then I got in and it was like, I didn't even know, you know, cause I had handguns and I was like, I want to be able to take these out of the house. California is a fucking dangerous place. People look like they're going to kill me for walking down the street.
Yeah, but you can't do that in Cali.
Yeah, you can't do it in Cali. And I was like researching getting a permit there. And it was like, it's possible in some parts of California, but not in LA County. And it was like, if we'd lived six blocks further, we would have been in Ventura County and probably could have gotten one. But, so I read the whole book in one sitting, got to the end of it and saw this URL for Free State Wyoming and went and looked at it. And this was about 11 PM at night. And I started chatting with people on there. And the next morning I woke my wife up early and said, we're moving to Wyoming. And she said,
Wow. So you're one of the few.
Yeah.
I didn't know that there are people still moving there for that.
I'm not though, because I'm not a Free State Wyoming. I never pledged. I actually pledged to New Hampshire. And then when I just moved to Wyoming, a few people on there yelled at me, a few idiots, but, you know, cause I don't like pledges. I never really took them. I think
they finally updated their website. The Free State Wyoming people.
I think you speak with your actions, not with your words, you know?
So. Yeah.
No, I'm friends with a few of them, and there's a bunch of them in the Guns and Weed movie. I mean, the old lady, the one who describes herself as the grandma nurse, Mama Liberty, she's one of them. The other older curmudgeonly guy, Mac, the guy in the red shirt that says a lot of the best stuff in the movie. You know, they're all Free State Wyoming people, and I'm friendly with them. I mean, they actually count me in their census, but I'm not a pledged member. They count us, my wife and I, because we moved here.
Well, I'm glad to see they're still around, because last I saw their website, it hadn't been updated in a while, but they have something going on. I guess they've got their little jamboree thing going on.
Yeah, I went to their equivalent of Pork Fest this year, and it was about 75 adults and probably 15 kids, and it was a real good time.
Cool. Good for them. I don't know what Porkfest started at, but I imagine it was probably similar numbers. And now we're getting close to 1,000. So, things are going well here.
Yeah. I think that the Wyoming one is about a third of the size pledged and in state. You got about 1,000 in state there. And how many pledged, right?
11,000 pledged.
And how many in state?
About 1,000, over 1,000.
Yeah. There's about 300 in state here. And I think about 3,000 or 4,000 pledged.
You'd think they'd advertise those numbers if they were that high. I don't see anything like that on their website.
There are a lot more. I mean, you can't really see a lot of that site without pledging. I can't even see a lot of that site, and I live here, and I've got like 4,000 posts on that site, which I have told the movers and shakers of them that that's part of the problem, is that they're too secretive about it to bring more people here, and they respond with, we're more concerned about quality than quantity. And
I see.
You know, but it's also like, that's not going to keep the Fed goons from reading the site.
Right.
They'll just pledge, you know?
Yeah.
So, it's a much more spread out state. I mean, it's,
tell me about it.
It would blow your mind. It would blow your mind how, I mean, a lot of places you can go, you know, you're lucky if you can go 20 minutes without seeing a cop. You can go 20 minutes driving without seeing a human or a car or a house here in a lot of the state. You know, I mean,
sure. Well, it takes 2.5 hours to drive across the widest portion of, you know, New Hampshire, 2.5-3 hours max if you're going slow.
Yeah. And, you know, here we got Cheyenne and Casper, both about 52,000 people. Then the next biggest town is 20,000 people. And the next biggest town is 12,000 people. And then most towns are under 5,000 people. And a lot of towns are like 600 people here. And there's just vast cows and wheat and sagebrush between it. I kind of like it. People bum me out. I don't like being around a lot of them. Although I live in town, but that's so my wife can work in an office and I can have DSL. Because if you don't live in town here, you got satellite.
Good luck.
It's slow, man. And it's expensive.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's that way. I hear there's plenty of woods where there's not jack for internet access. And
yeah, so Mark, I'm going to be interviewing Mark next month. And he said he'd have to come into the station to do it.
Yeah, for sure.
What does he have, dial-up or satellite?
He's on satellite.
Yeah.
Which is basically dial-up for upstream, so there's nothing. Satellite you can get okay downstream, but upstream is useless.
Yeah, so you couldn't podcast from it unless it was 5-minute episodes crunched down to 16K or something.
Or as long as you're willing to wait all night long to upload something, sure.
Or if something, does it get knocked offline like dial-up did?
If there's enough cloud cover or rain fade, sure.
Yeah, I forgot to mention, do you know about the Mission Radio, the long-running pirate station in San Francisco?
I've heard of Pirate Cat Radio. They got raided not too long ago. I don't think I've heard of Mission Radio.
Yeah, I've been interviewed on mission radio in their facilities. It's pretty cool. It's pretty neat. Bunch of hippies. Smells like hemp and patchouli and
sweat. The hippies are way better at pirate radio than Liberty people. The
Berkeley people.
Yep, the Radio Free Berkeley, yeah. And those guys are on the ball and they know what they're doing. They've had years of experience at it. And Liberty people, you know, they're just I guess they're pussies in comparison. They're just too scared of the FCC.
They're too scared. And the Berkeley people have all the good scientists, it seems like. I mean, there's a few of those Berkeley guys I think are like Vietnam vet, you know, radio engineers who were trained by the government, who really know their stuff from back then for you know, analog, making something cheap and powerful. And I mean, they have tutorials on YouTube about how to do it, and it's
it's guys
that make young Quaker look, that make bad Quaker look like a young metrosexual, you know. It's like old guys that look like Moses with, you know, pot leaf t-shirts on, talking about how to do pirate radio. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, well, those guys inspired me to some extent when I was reading about pirate radio in the late 1990s. I've been a fan of pirate radio for a long time. And so it's cool that, like, now I can use the money I'm making at legitimate commercial radio to promote the idea of people broadcasting illegally.
Well, I don't condone any illegal behavior. I'm a good law-abiding citizen. I just say that every 5 minutes. You know, it's like you have to have FCC makes you have a station ID every hour. I just have to say every 5 minutes that I don't break any laws. I should just make a loop of it, a little bump.
Yeah. I don't believe you.
I don't, man.
No, I don't believe you. Everyone breaks the law.
Well, in that
you can't not.
In that three felonies a day sense of, I probably break laws I don't know I'm breaking because everyone does. But no, I don't break laws that I'm aware of breaking. Put it that way.
You never speed?
Last time we got pulled over for speeding, it was interesting. I've only had contact with cops three times in 3 years in Wyoming. Once was when we get to get our concealed carry permits, which we don't need anymore. And the cop were really friendly about it. They were like, oh, you're getting a gun. What kind of gun? Here's what I carry, you know. And then twice getting pulled over for speeding. Once was out in the middle of nowhere, and it was the cop gave us, it was like getting a ticket from a machine. I mean, it was a cop that was just hanging out all day, giving 20 tickets, you know, that kind of thing. And
so you admit then breaking the law.
I wasn't driving. My wife was driving. I was an accessory.
Very,
I guess.
Sneaky.
But,
what about buckling up? Do you have to buckle up out there?
Yes, but they can't pull you over for that. It has to be a second. It's only secondary, a secondary offense. Thing. Yeah. They're getting more. I mean, this place was kind of like the Wild West in a good way when I moved here 3 years ago. And the Republican, the small government Republicans, who are all just basically Christian Shereans, have tried their best to criminalize everything they can since then.
Yikes.
You know, they're like, I mean, they actually have a thing now where if you refuse a breathalyzer, they will hold you down and give you a blood test.
Whoa. Yeah, that's coming around in different places. Pretty scary.
Yeah. And they've actually tried it. Like in Cheyenne, five cops held a guy down and blood test. Wow. But, you know, for the most part, it's...
Well, if you stay inside most of the time, then you can see the cops very often here, too.
Yeah, and there's just so few and far... Police are few and far between here per square mile. But the other time we got pulled over, we were speeding in town, like, you know, going 38 in a 25 zone or something, and the cop pulled us over. It was the most bizarre encounter I've ever had with a cop. In Lib Pair, it would probably work something like this, except there wouldn't be a libertarian paradise. We got pulled over, young cop, asked my wife for driver's license. She gave it to him. Asked us for the papers, please. But I had my glove compartment open with a loaded 5-shot 38 special sitting in it in plain view, in grabbable view. And I said to the cop, officer, before I reach in to get the insurance papers, I'd like to point out that, you know, cause I didn't want him shooting and saying I was reaching for a gun. And he interrupted my sentence and said, I see the gun. Just please give me the insurance papers.
Right.
Blew me away. Also because that same month in Southern California, my stepson got pulled over and thrown to the ground and handcuffed at gunpoint for rolling a stop sign. And when they discovered legally possessed ammunition on him, no guns, no drugs, no cash, nothing, you know, that other than a bunch of Moson Nagant ammo in a spam can, you know, tin can unopened, like you need a can opener to open it. And they said it was armor piercing, cop killing bullets, and yelled at him for 40 minutes while holding guns to his head and swore at him and called him all kinds of names until the watch.
This was in Cheyenne?
No, this was in Orange County, California.
Oh, Orange County. I'm sorry.
And then the watch commander showed up and said, that's legal ammunition for an antique gun. Let him go. You know,
wow.
But the same month, my cop gun interaction was, yeah, I see the gun. Whatever. Give me the papers.
Oh, yeah. That's how they are out here in Keene. Pretty cool about it.
He did not give us a ticket, too. It was real, you know, he gave us a warning. He said, it's a really nice day. This was the lib pair cop kind of thing. Like in the private roads, yeah. I think the cops would do this. They pull you over when you're going too fast and say, it's a really nice, he said, it's a really nice day and I'd hate to see you get in an accident. Please drive safely.
Mm, that's nice.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, they do that here too. I mean, you look at the police logs and it shows they give people warnings pretty often. And when it comes to guns, I think the Manchester cops are a bunch of assholes, but in Keene, we've got a cool group as far as on the gun issue is concerned. They're all pretty good on it. So like one example is when Anarcho Jesse was doing his illegal gardening out at Central Square, he brought a rifle with him to, I guess he said it was to shoot any gophers that might pop up. But he leans the rifle up against a tree, which I didn't think was a really good idea because, you know, kids could come around or whatever.
Yeah.
And but it was pretty early in the morning, and he leans his rifle up against the tree, and of course the cops show up. They're there waiting for him, and he starts hoeing the ground illegally, and they quickly arrest him. And Maxfield, the lieutenant, asks me if I can take the gun, and I was like, yeah, that's no problem. So, you know, in any other place except for Wyoming and a handful of other places, you know, place like California or wherever, they're probably going to take that gun. But here in Keene, he asked me to kind of take it off their hands and take it away, and he arrested Anarcho Jesse and took him away, and I took the gun away. And then in another instance, which more recent, Rich Paul was downtown, and he had his gun with him. And he was, you know, he was strapped and had a backpack on. He was arrested for a bench warrant, and the cop said to him, I'm going to take this gun and I'm going to put it in your bag, and I'm not going to look in the bag. And he puts the gun in the bag, doesn't look in the bag. And then I showed up on the scene because we've got pretty good communications methods here. Rich had texted that he was, you know, being arrested, and I live pretty close to downtown, so I'd hopped on my bike and had arrived on the scene while he was being put in the car. And he asked if I could take the bag away, and the cop had no problem with me taking that bag away from that scene. So that was pretty cool. You know, there's little incidents like that that let you know, like, yeah, things are a little bit better here. They're still really crappy in some ways, but they're a little bit better here.
Yeah, Wyoming is kind of the gun and weed laws are kind of the opposite of California. Like in California, you know, you can have weed, you can get a permit for it, or you can just have it, and it's barely like a traffic ticket or anything. And you know, if you have a gun in public in your pocket or in a holster, that's a year in prison automatically. And in
Wyoming, don't want to be in California prison.
Yeah, and in Wyoming, they're real fucking serious about any drugs, and will
really prosecute. Okay, so it's Montana that's got the medical marijuana,
right, and Colorado. We're surrounded by it. But
got it. It's like that here in New Hampshire.
Not
all
Wyoming.
The other states have medical.
And you know, guns are sacred here. I mean, when the governor, who's governor now, was running for office, Nima was working as a TV reporter and went and interviewed him, and I went with him, and we went to a gun range and shot with him. And you know, I was letting his 11-year-old daughter use my revolver and showing her how to fire it, and he was standing 10 feet away and barely blinked. You know, I mean, can you imagine that in California or Massachusetts? You know, and it's everybody here hunts. I mean, hunting season, like literally, like stores close downtown the first couple of days of deer season here, and everyone's got a rifle in their car. I don't know that many people carry handguns here, and I've open carried a lot when I first got here before I got my permit, because it was how to legally carry. And my neighbors were just, you know, my garbage man was like, why are you doing that? Why are you open carrying? And I said, well, because I haven't lived here 6 months yet, so I can't get a permit. And he said, just do what we all do. Just put it in your pocket. And this was before it was legal to do that. And this, you know, my really square, upstanding, law-abiding neighbor was just put it in your pocket so it doesn't frighten the kids, you know.
Wow, that's funny.
Yeah.
So even in gun-friendly Wyoming, people are bitching about open carry. Jeez.
Well, but unlike any other state I know of, I don't know of anybody, and I know a couple, you know, probably, I probably know 10 of the 15 people in the state that regularly open carry, and nobody has ever been thrown to the ground for it. Nobody has ever been hassled for it. I've done it a whole lot all over the state, and I've had people stare at it, but the only comment we ever got was some tourist from Iowa at a truck stop. The little girl said to my wife, mommy, she's got a gun. And the mother shielded the child's face with her hands and quickly walked away.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw a lady do the same thing the other day at the airport with Kelly Voluntarius walking around.
I like those videos.
Fun. Good.
Yep.
I'm glad.
Yep. So I just wanted to ask you about a real serious subject, about the guy who immolated himself, who burned himself to death as a protest in New Hampshire. Tell me about
Thomas
that.
James Ball. Yeah, he set himself on fire out in front of the courthouse here, same courthouse where I was sentenced to jail for 90 days for standing in front of a police car, same courthouse where many families have been broken apart and just, of course, a lot of people just run roughshod over by these judges. And that's what drove this man to the brink of madness, or the brink of total frustration, in that he spent the last decade of his life just dealing with hell from this court system, trying to see his kids. And he ended up setting himself ablaze, sent a lengthy suicide note to the local newspaper. And over at freekeen.com, we were covering this and actually scooped the news on a lot of things regarding this this whole situation. I spent a couple hours looking through his case file in the court, which was just, they had two huge files that, you know, were as thick as your fist, full of papers. And it was just really brutal looking through it. But you know, they just ruined this guy's life, and he was facing jail time for being behind on child support payments. He didn't have a job, so how he was supposed to make those payments, I'm not real sure. And how you're supposed to make those payments from inside a jail cell, I'm certainly not sure. And I guess he just decided he'd rather set himself on fire than have to continue to deal with this and possibly face jail time, etc. So that's what happened. Of course, the government tried to brush it under the rug as much as possible. They painted over the area in which he set himself ablaze, painted over the black marks the next day. We did manage to get a photo of the black marks prior to that happening, which may be one of the only photos of that available, because they've completely blocked any access to any of the police reports, to any of the photos that the police took, to the video footage that was taken by the security cameras. And the reason they did that was because they claimed that someone from the family did not want that information getting out. So despite the fact that Thomas James Ball self-immolated in a very public manner, because he wanted people to know why and he wanted people to ask questions about it, the court system refuses to show any transparency. And it was me. I was the one who filed the request for those documents, and the city took me to court to have a judge decide in that case, and they finally did decide, as I expected, in favor of secrecy. So
the guy didn't do anything of sending a copy of it to independent media instead of just the mainstream media?
Yeah, he only sent it to the newspaper.
See, there you go. Should have sent it to 10 prominent bloggers.
He should have sent it to Freekeen, but you know, 10, that's
anybody, any, you know, he should have sent it to a blogger, anybody, because it would get reblogged and recovered, you know.
Well, the newspaper printed his letter. The newspaper covered the story, but the story didn't get coverage really beyond Keene very far at all. I mean, if you go to Google and type in Thomas James Ball, Freekeen story is going to come up because there's just not that much coverage out there. And that's because no one cares when someone sets themselves on fire in the U.S. They just must be crazy. And so therefore they have nothing.
It's really intense. I mean, it reminded me, you know, I grew up watching the Vietnam War on TV, and there were some monks doing that. And it was one of the most shocking things I saw as a kid, and just the world is a fucked up place. And why are they doing this? And, you know, and it was part of what made me hate war from, you know, 1969 on, that and the fact that I was watching the war on TV. But, it was really intense, and it's too bad that it got under the rug so much, and it was good that you got some of it out, some of the dust bunnies out from under the rug for people to see.
It's been the most linked to, or it's been the most trafficked article at Freekeen for quite a while. So it's going pretty strong, even though it from just people talking on the internet, even though at no point did the media really seem to give a damn about it.
You know, I would like to see in media, and since I don't see this, maybe I'll have to do it myself. I would like to see people revisiting stories like that from a year or two or three ago, because they make the news for a week and everybody talks about them, and then they forget about them. Like, what, you know, what have you heard lately about the guy who's in jail for making silver coins? What have you heard lately about the Marine that was killed in his home in Arizona? What have you heard about, you know, anything that was a banner headline, even 6 months ago or a year or two ago of liberty related stuff? There's so much more garbage being foisted at us every day that we have to talk about, so much more tyranny today, that there isn't a lot of time to cover the old stuff. And I posted something today that I thought was a news story that wasn't, but it's being revisited for a good reason. It's the guy who was shot by police when he hit his med alert bracelet because he was having heart problems, and the police showed up and broke in his door and killed him. It's being brought up because he was a black man, and in, you know, people are saying, where is his outrage over, like, compared to the Trayvon Martin case, and that it's being swept under the rug because it was a police action rather than a citizen action. But I'd like to see some of that stuff brought and revisited more.
Yeah, I expect we're probably going to have some sort of a revisitation of Thomas Ball on his anniversary, the first anniversary, which will be coming up on June 15th. So I imagine that something will happen. And one of the good things that came out of it was that because Freekeen was doing reporting on the issue, there were people obviously coming to the website. And so there's a number of abused dads and moms that have been screwed by the court system that have kind of come to Freekeen as a result of us covering Thomas Ball. And so we got together, we met some of them in person, and I actually went up to Concord the other day with Ed, who's one of the abused fathers, and he's become quite a good ally for Freekeen. And so it's certainly helped bring some people together who otherwise wouldn't have. Certainly Tom Ball's wishes were not fulfilled by anyone. He kind of had a violent solution in mind. He wanted somebody else to burn down the courthouse. He wasn't willing to do it.
I read his letter.
I don't support that.
It put a weird twist on self-immolation, because self-immolation is an interest. I mean, I don't condone it, but it's shocking as a story, and it's inward turned violence to get a point across. But he wanted people to do more. Was he a Free State person, Free State Project guy?
Thomas Ball? No.
Yeah.
He was people, I think, originally were trying to, Massachusetts, and I think he lived in Massachusetts at the time when he killed himself, but the situation with his children was happening in Cheshire Superior Court.
Did anyone try to link him with Free State Project?
Not that I noticed, no.
I mean, I saw some people wondering about it before it was sure that he wasn't. But I don't know if anyone was trying to link it to it.
No, I think that, I can't be positive on this, but I remember one time we were coming back from Massachusetts because we kept going back to Greenfield due to them arresting our friends Pete and Adamo from Cop Block down there for wiretapping and other things. But I was coming back from Greenfield once, and it was really cold out, and there was some guy standing out in the ice and the snow and the freezing temperatures, standing all by himself in Troy, New Hampshire, which is on the way back up to Keene, in the town common, right out by the circle where a bunch of cars pass by, and he had a sign relating to father or family rights and or the court system. And I believe that same guy called Free Talk Live at one time, but I don't recall well enough as to whether or not his name was Tom. And I have a feeling that was him, because I know that's one of the things he supposedly did was do protests, and it wouldn't surprise me if he was doing it all alone. But I think that would have been my only interaction with the guy.
It's sad.
It's really sad. And he's not the only one who's experiencing it. I mean, like I said, ever since then, I've been meeting some of these guys who, and ladies, it's mostly men, but there are some women that have been screwed over too. Meeting these people that, for lack of a better term, are the abused parents of this so-called justice system, and hearing their stories, it's terrible. It really is bad. There's some hearings going on in New Hampshire now, because there's a new grievance panel, which has never existed before the last year or so, where people can actually bring grievances against the governments, various different government people. And so one of those grievances has to do with the Cheshire County Courthouse and the court system in general. So we may see some changes to the system. There are a few different proposals on the table for constitutional amendments that I think will have to be voted on this year at the election that could result in taking some power away from the court systems. But I don't know if it's going to significantly change
how these folks' cases. It's a tough one because it's so filled with think of the children, you know.
Yeah.
Where the state does a pretty bad job of thinking of the children. Hey, did you see this this thing from 2 days ago? Boston settled police videotaping lawsuit.
Yep, Simon Glick, the guy that in the Glick decision, which basically reaffirmed the idea that it should be okay to record these police bureaucrats, was awarded that money. So
what's
they arrested
status?
The wrong guy. They arrested a lawyer.
What's the status with what's the status with your friend's case?
Jason Talley, he was in court this week for a pretrial hearing, and there's some motions in play which may delay his case. So it's still running. So even though the New Hampshire Attorney General had put out a press release, or not a press release, but they put out a notice to all of the police departments in New Hampshire, alerting them, "Hey, this Glick thing happened, and you have to allow people to record you," is what he told all these people. But that hasn't resulted in Jason Talley having his charges dropped. So here in Cheshire County, they do whatever the fuck they want, and they'll get away with it. So it seems, unless we can get some more people here to help out with changing things.
Hey, why do they call it the Shire? Is that a Free State Project term, or is that something that existed before? I asked my sister, who lived in New Hampshire in the 70s, and she'd never heard it.
Yeah, it's relatively new as of the last decade. The New Hampshire Free website, nhfree.com, there's a forum there. It's called the New Hampshire Underground, and it's the original New Hampshire Liberty Activism website. It was in existence prior to Free Keen and prior to pretty much anything else up here. It used to be a pretty healthy forum. It's kind of died down to just a few hardcores. But that was where the Shire terminology came from. It came from Russell and Kat Canning. I don't know if they're the originators of the idea, but someone on that forum probably came up with it. And they're just kind of, they're folks that have had a lot of fun doing their activism. They did some civil disobedience, kind of did a lot of street theater, and were poking a lot of fun at the state. I missed them a lot, and they were a big influence for me to come up here. And so they came up with the Shire, and they came up with Shire time, like a different time kind of structure instead of dealing with the whole jumping forward and jumping back situation.
Is it a Hobbit reference?
I don't know. It may have something to do with that. I'm really not sure. It probably does, but I really don't know. That would be the place to go and ask about it, though. I guess talked about enough to make an impression on some people, and I guess people liked it, so it stuck.
Cool, man. I think I'm tapped out with questions here, unless you have a follow-up closing arguments or anything.
Well, I'm glad you brought up the Shire, because it's kind of a bit of a competitor to the Free State Project. That's what it's turned into. Originally, it was kind of a fun thing.
Oh, they're not. I thought they were the same. I thought the Shire was New Hampshire.
It is. But it's also a state of mind. You can be in the Shire, and you can be part of the Shire anywhere. But no, the Shire Society is something that was created within the last few years, where at the 2010 Porcupine Freedom Festival, we had the Shire Society Declaration signing. And the Declaration is something that we kind of cribbed from a science fiction author, Patrick Harris or whatever his name is.
L. Neil Smith.
That's it. And he had posted something in one of his books, or there was a page in one of his books that was kind of like this declaration of sovereignty or declaration of, I forget what it was even called, the original. But basically, we kind of used that as our basis to create the Shire Society Declaration. And L. Neil Smith ended up getting pretty pissed off about that because he believes in intellectual property.
You know, he is a huge influence on my worldview. His two graphic novels, what are they called? I can't remember the names of them right now, but there's two that I really liked. It's like how I picture libertarian paradise would be, and it still forms a lot of it in my mind. So he was kind of a hero of mine. And then I've had nothing but like curmudgeonly interactions with him on the internet.
Yeah, he was not very nice about it, and you know, ended up coming to nothing. And you know, we still have the Shire Society Declaration. It was signed by a whole bunch of people, and in person, we had it written up in calligraphy on really fancy, you know, hemp paper.
So
everything.
Wait, he owns the copyright on pledges?
Well, he didn't like the idea that somebody would have taken something of his without paying him and modified it to be something different.
Oh, man.
Which is, you know, what we did. And, you know, we didn't apologize for it. I, There's a lot of drama. If you really want to go, and you can you know, dig it all up if you want to. But the idea was to give people another society that they could join. Because what happened to me, at least, was that sometimes I would be doing my activism, and I'd get into a conversation with some bureaucrat about some absurd rule that they have, and they would say something to the effect of, "Well, you're part of our society." And so we figured, well, let's create another society. That way, if they say that, we can say, no, we're actually a member of this society over here. It's a peaceful one where people interact voluntarily, and it's not coercive like your state society is. So the idea is it's kind of like a personal declaration of independence, and folks can go to shiresociety.com. They can sort of sign it online via their Facebook account, or just leave a comment on the site, or there's one that you can print out, and you can have your own fancy-looking Shire Society declaration. And, you know, it's kind of got that Declaration of Independence feel to it, but it's much more focused on the individual. And, you know, we're not intending to create a government after this. We just want to declare independence and create the alternative consensual society that we all want to live in. And, of course, encourage people to move to the Shire, which commonly is known as the place that most people know as New Hampshire. But yeah, it is also a state of mind. But clearly, we want people of that state of mind to consider moving together with others of that particular state of mind, so we can all live more free together and be more safe from the aggressive criminal gang of warlords that is out and about in the Shire right now.
Cool. Sounds excellent. I'm in a nation of two, so it's not for me, but it sounds excellent. All right, man. I think that's it. Thanks for coming on the show.
No problem, man.
Take care, brother.
Take it easy. Thank you.
Yep.